Jesus, draw me ever nearer.
Yeah. everyone, and Merry Christmas to everybody. We're going to focus on today on the Magi. I want to start from a little insert out of O. Henry's play, The Gift of the Magi. The Gift of the Magi is a play about young Jim and his wife Della, who are a couple who are living in a very modest apartment. They find themselves, their money very tight. And there's two possessions that each one of them has that they take great pride in. Della has her beautiful long hair, while Jim has his watch that has been passed on from generation to generation. On Christmas Eve, we find out that Della has $1.87 in hand. And she wants to find a gift for Jim, but just realizes that there's just not enough money. So she goes to the nearby hairdresser and sells her beautiful hair for $20, which ends up being right about enough for her to buy a chain for Jim's watch at $21, leaving her about 87 cents left over. Satisfied with this perfect gift, she goes home and prepares a pork chop dinner. At 7 o'clock, Della sits at the table near the door, waiting for Jim to come home. Unusually late, Jim walks in and immediately stops short at the sight of Della. Della had prayed that he would still find her beautiful and attractive, but he is stopped short. And she admits to him that the reason why she sold her hair was in order for him to have the perfect gift. Jim gives Della her gift. She opens it up. And it's an assortment of expensive hair accessories, otherwise known as the combs, useless now that her hair is short. Della then shows Jim the chain that she bought him, to which Jim had sold his watch to purchase the money for her combs. Although Jim and Della are now left with gifts that neither one of them can use, they realize how far they are willing to go to show their love for each other. And just how priceless their love really is. And it is at the end of the story that says, the Magi, as you know, were wise men, wonderfully wise men, who brought gifts to the newborn King of the Jews in the manger. They invented the art of giving Christmas presents. Being wise, their gifts were no doubt wise ones, possibly bearing the privilege of exchange in case of duplication. And here I have lamely related to you the uneventful chronicle of two foolish children and a flat who most unwisely sacrificed each other the greatest treasures in their home. But in a last word to the wives of these days, let it be said that all who give gifts, these two are the wisest. Of all who give and receive gifts such as these, they are the wisest. Everywhere, they are the wisest. They are the Magi. The Magi is what we're going to take some time taking a look at today, and their gifts. So if you want to turn to Matthew chapter 2, that's where we'll be taking the passage from today. And I would like to focus on the gifts of the Magi. The gifts that the Magi gave were gifts fitting for a king, a God, and a Savior. The first three verses of Matthew chapter 2 says this: after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod, wise men from the east arrived unexpectedly in Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who has been born the King of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east, and have come to worship him. When King Herod heard this, he was deeply disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. The events of the Magi. Who were the Magi? Well, we know them to be the wise men, as tradition has called them. We don't really know much about them. This passage is the only time in which they are mentioned. Assumptions or tradition will tell us these were men of high position from Parthia, which actually was a great empire from ancient Babylon, and they had probably the second greatest military only to Rome. But we don't know much about them. We don't know for sure that's where they came from. We do know that they followed a star. How did they know that they needed to follow the star? Well, they could have been Jews left over from the exile when the Jews were exiled to Babylon in the Old Testament. If any Jew at this point in time would have been well-versed in the predictions of the Messiah, so this would have been something they were very familiar with. may have been astrologers, those who study stars and ancient books, to know what the star meant and its meaning behind it. They could have received a message directly from God. It's just simply not mentioned in those scriptures. The message that Jesus was the king was for everyone, not only for those in Jerusalem and Bethlehem, but for across the globe. But I want to focus on the reason why the Magi came and the gifts that they brought. The Magi traveled thousands of miles to see the King of the Jews. When they finally found him, they responded with great joy, worship, and gifts. This is such a different approach than the way people take today. We expect God to come looking for us, to explain himself, to prove who he is, and to give us gifts. But those who are wise still seek and worship Christ. Today, not for what they can get, but for who he is. That's why they came. That's why they worship. But sadly, many of us are consumers. And we want to consume. We want to worship and praise God only for our own benefit, instead of taking a look and being able to benefit those around us. But there's a message behind each and every one of these gifts that I think is important for each and every one of us. The first gift that was given was the gift of gold, a gift for a king. Gold was typically given in that day to royalty. And when they gave the gift symbolized the king of the Jews, of which they believed they were visiting. But the reason for the gift giving, the wise men brought the gifts to worship Jesus for who he was. This is the essence of true worship. Honoring Christ for who he is, being willing to give him what is of value to you. As we see their pattern of worship, we should model that for our own pattern of worship. First of all, they entered. They prepared for the journey, studied and sought him out. We should be prepared for worship. They bowed. They humbled themselves in the presence of the superior, acknowledging Christ's authority. They humbled themselves. When we come into worship, can we take that moment to decide that it's not about us, but it's about who we're here to worship, who we are here to give praise? They gave. They gave expensive, sacrificial gifts out of respect and honor for the Christ child. Then they worshiped. They recognized God's guidance in bringing them to Jesus as royalty. They exalted Jesus as the rightful king, and they obeyed. When the worship was done, God came to them and told them to go a different way, and they obeyed. How is that our pattern of worship? When we come here, we should be ready to worship. We should bow and humble ourselves and decide it's not about us, but it's about what we're giving to God. And we should give. The gift of gold was a gift of finance. And for us, we have to evaluate our own giving. What are we giving to God? So many times people get so focused on when they give a gift, it's to the, quote, church. I'm going to support the church. I'm going to support this. But what if we changed our perspective? Instead of saying, I'm supporting the church, I'm supporting God. I'm supporting his work. I'm giving money knowing that I'm not necessarily going to get much back. But I'm giving because God has blessed me with it. And it's my way of worshiping him. I can bless Christ with the gold that I have. And I know it's not literal gold, but with the finances, the money that we have, we can be a blessing to God. We can see God's kingdom work. We can see great things happen in God's kingdom when we're willing to give. Robert Weber says something very profound about worship. And he said, worship is a meeting between God and his people when the worshiper is brought into a personal contact with the one who gives meaning, purpose to life. From this encounter, the worshiper receives strength, courage to live with hope in a fallen world. That was a gift for a king. We ask ourselves in our own worship, what am I giving? What am I giving financially? How am I giving? Am I giving like the wise man, giving with intention, and giving as an act of worship? But the other gifts that are in this passage are just as profound. As we take a look at verses 4, we go on to read, "So he assembled all the chief priests and scribes to the people he'd been Herod, and asked them where the Messiah would be to be born. In Bethlehem of Judea, they told him, because this is what was written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among leaders of Judah, because out of you will come a leader who will be shepherd my people Israel.' And Herod secretly summoned the wise men and asked for the exact time the star appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go search carefully for the child. When you find him, report back to me, so that I too can go and worship him.' After hearing the king, they went on their way, and there it was, a star that they had seen in the east, and led them until it came and stopped above the place where the child was." They gave the gift of frankincense. Before we go into frankincense, when I read this passage, and maybe for many of you, you're in the same boat, when we read this passage, we ask ourselves the question, what's Herod's problem? It said that Herod is quite disturbed when the Magi is asking about the newborn king. And he had every right to be disturbed in his own eyes. He was not the rightful heir to the throne of David. He was placed there by Rome, and the Jews didn't like him for that. Herod was ruthless. Because of his many enemies, he was always suspicious of people and actually had people killed because he viewed them as a threat. Herod didn't want the Jews, a religious group, to unite over a religious figure. They would be a threat. And if the Magi were truly from Parthia, then again, they would be very powerful. Just like I said, they had the most powerful army second only to Rome. So again, they would be a threat to Rome, which Rome was the place that put Herod in that place. So he didn't trust what was going on. It wasn't only King Herod. The text tells us that it wasn't only Herod that was disturbed, but everyone in Jerusalem. When Jesus was born into the world, people immediately began to react. His presence did not soothe and comfort most people. Instead, it startled and disturbed them. For some, he awakened a spiritual longing. But for others, it was fear and insecurity. I ask you the question, what has changed 2,000 years later? Jesus still disturbs people. If it is true that God entered our world when Jesus was born, we dare not sit idly ignoring and rationalizing our actions. But too many times, people just feel threatened. They feel disturbed. We have to acknowledge that Christ is Lord of our life. Herod fought that tooth and nail when he came up with the plan, "I'll go and worship the Christ child." He fought that with all he could, and he has this plan. He's going to see the Christ child, and there he can eliminate the threat. But God isn't fooled by Herod. And God isn't fooled by us. I ask you this question. How many of us are sincerely allowing Christ to change our lives? Are sincerely allowing our lives to be changed by our Lord who gave his life for us? All too often we play the Christian card. We play church. We say the right things, do the right things, all so that people can be impressed by the kind of Christian we are. Well, I got news for you. King Herod wasn't fooling anybody, and neither are we. God knows those who are pure in heart. And I encourage you to seek God and become pure in heart. But let's go back to this gift of deity, frankincense. Frankincense may not be something that you're familiar with. I'll tell you a little bit about frankincense. Frankincense was an incense. It was a perfume. And it was meant during the sacrifices to a god. Today, if someone is ordained by the Lord Jesus Christ into the ministry, they're ordained into the ministry. The oil which is used to anoint them actually have little fragments of frankincense in it. Why? Because the whole idea is for them to be set apart to do God's work. So it's a gift of deity. It's a sacrifice of one sacrificing their life, sacrificing their worship to the one true God. This gift is a humbling gift. It's a gift of worship. We know God. We know who he is. And this gift of deity is giving to God our worship. So I ask you, when you come to worship God, are you giving Him your worship? All too often, we want to make God part of our life, but then things come up. When things come up, then we miss the service here and there. And there's nothing wrong with that, but then when it becomes frequent is when the problem will arise. Is your worship sacred to you? Is your worship important enough to you for you to come here week in and week out? And when you come here, are you able to remove your, clear your mind of all the distractions in this world and just focus on worship? God's not asking for much. He's asking for you to come for an hour and a half, go through a service, pray and worship Him. Keep the distractions at bay and focus solely on His kingdom. So what are we giving God? Are we giving God our time? Are we giving God our worship? The gift of gold should remind us of the gift that we are giving God financially, but the gift of frankincense should remind us of what we're giving Him in our worship, what we're giving Him in our service, and how well we're trying to accomplish that. The last gift is the gift of myrrh. And we'll finish out the passage and talk about that. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed beyond measure. Entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. Falling to their knees, they worshipped Him. Then they opened their treasures and presented to Him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Being warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their own country by another route. We spent a lot of time talking about the wise men. We haven't spent any time talking about the Christ family, Christ child family. Where was Mary and Joseph at this time? They were clearly still in Bethlehem, but they were no longer in the stable. They got out of the stable, thankfully. They're now in a home, in a house. They were married, probably standing, planning on staying a while. The Christ child was a toddler, so anywhere between 12 and 24 month range. And even though God appeared to the wise men and told them to go a different way, He also appeared to Joseph and told him to fly to go to Egypt. And upon moving to Egypt, they would eventually come back to Nazareth. But He told them to go to Egypt because Herod had a scheme. Herod's plan was to go around killing all the newborn baby boys from 2 years and under. And Christ's child would be a threat in that location. But He tells them to move out of protection. So God is with them the whole way. The Christ child would give His life for the Lord or for our cause to pay the ultimate gift, but not now. He had more things in store for Him. But I want to go back to the Magi's gifts. These were expensive gifts. These were gifts of sacrifice. The gold was a gift for royalty. The frankincense was a gift of God. But the myrrh was a gift for death. A strange gift to give a baby. But it would be Christ's death that would be the ultimate gift. As the Magi brought the gifts and worshiped Christ for who He was, they understood the true essence of worship, honoring Christ for who He was and being willing to give Him something of value. They worship God because God is perfect. He is just. He is almighty creator of the universe, worthy of the best that they had to give. And that same is true for us. He is worthy of the best that we have to offer. God gave us the ultimate gift. It was thousands of years in the making, but He gave us the ultimate gift. He had planned it out, everything to a T. And it would start by the precious cry of the Christ child. In the face of the Christ child, this toddler that the Magi were worshiping would be in the face of mercy. The fact that we do not receive what we truly deserve. For our disobedience, for our turning our backs on God, we deserve far worse than we're going to get, but it is mercy that stops that from happening. But we're also given grace. We don't deserve heaven. We don't deserve forgiveness. We don't deserve any of that. But Christ is willing to give to us anyway. Faith in Christ child is also forgiveness. I don't know about you, but I'm sure many of us are guilty of all kinds of sins. We're not going to name those sins today. That's not what we're here for. But we are guilty of all kinds of sins, disobedience, shortcomings. But Christ is willing to forgive us of all that, completely washing away our slate, as if we never committed them. It's also in the face of Christ that we obtain our salvation, the promise of everlasting life in heaven. Christ gave his life. He came here, lived his life on this earth, gave his life so that you and I will have the opportunity for heaven. But what are we giving back? A lot of times, we as Christians, what we give back to God is nothing but a bunch of excuses. I'm too busy to serve God. Too emotional, too hurt, too disturbed. I'm too distracted to serve God. I'm too self-absorbed, self-centered to serve God. Bottom line, I'm too wrapped up in everything and everyone else to spend time serving God. Instead, I want to sit back and be a consumer. I just want to be a customer. I come here and I just want God to take care of me. Do you realize the problem with that thought process? First of all, that's not what you're called to. That's not what it is to be a Christian. What it is to be a Christian is to follow the model of the Magi. To be willing to go thousands of miles. To give the gifts that God has blessed us with. To see his kingdom grow. How many of us are willing to do that? Or how many of us just want to sit back and let God take care of us? Sadly, 98% of the church, and I'm talking about church across the board, will be content this year by just sitting back and letting God and other people take care of them when it comes to their worship. 2% will actually get it and know that our worship is here for us so that we can reach out for those who don't know Christ or those who have left who need to come back. God has awesome plans in store for us. There's lots of vision in store for you if you're willing to be like the Magi and give the gifts that you have. God has given each and every one of us talents to use. Are you willing to give them to him? As we conclude, the musicians come forward. I want to leave you with a quote by Lucinda Franks. Christmas in Bethlehem, the ancient dream of a cold, clear night made brilliant by a glorious star. The smell of incense, shepherds, and wise men falling to their knees in adoration of the sweet baby, the incarnation of perfect love. What are we willing to give? What are we willing to sacrifice? What are we willing to give up? Are we like the Magi? Are we willing to give financially to support God's kingdom? Are we willing to give our time and our sacrifice in order to spend time in worship for our God and give him the gift of frankincense? The bottom line, are we willing to live our life for God? To follow his vision for our life and give the gift of myrrh, the gift of life. What are you willing to give? God has given each and every one of his gifts and talents to use. Are we willing to be part of the solution to build his kingdom? Or are we satisfied with just sitting back and being what the stores want you to be, a bunch of customers? I hope and pray that each and every one of us will take to heart the fact that we are called to be Magi, to come to God, to give him our gifts, and to worship him not for what we're going to get in return, but because of who he is. Let's stand as we enter into these final moments of worship.